ولد الهدى فالكائنات ضياء.
Sorry to cut you. So what I'm saying, likewise, what they prophesize about each other, like Jesus prophesies about Prophet Muhammad, Moses, Isaiah, even though they exist 1,000 years or less or more, yet they prophesize about Prophet Muhammad. Likewise, Prophet Muhammad prophesies about the future. That's why, as Muslims, we don't just believe the Prophet Muhammad because I was born a Muslim. Rather, we have intellectual and rational proofs and tangible proofs to establish Muhammad is a true prophet of God. If he is, then logic dictates you should believe what he came with, because God, the creator, will not choose a liar to convey his message.
Do you identify him?
What do you mean by that?
What do you mean by that? There's proofs and evidence to show that this is the prophet.
For example, the rabbis. The rabbis that exist Prophet Muhammad saw some time. The rabbis, one of them, he was Abdullah ibn Salam. He was a rabbi. Prophet Muhammad came to Medina. He was a rabbi. He said, I bear witness, you are the messenger that has been mentioned in our book.
So the Jewish
rabbi. Likewise, the Christians, even the Christians. Like, you remember, the Christians, they were controlling Syria, Palestine, they were controlling Yemen, they were controlling part of Africa, they were controlling part of like Turkey, Iraq. After what happened, in the gap of or period of time of 20 years, most of the world became Muslims. Most of Christians except Islam.
So why, if the Jewish rabbis, said that?
Some of them knew he was a true prophet, but they rejected him. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. يعرفونه, I'll translate it. يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم. They know him just as they know their own sons. Why they rejected him? Because the Jews always expected the prophet to come from their lineage. When the prophet came outside their lineage, they rejected it. So therefore, they were not following the prophet because he was the prophet of God. They were following him because he was from their tribe. But we follow Allah and his prophet not because from my tribe.
They were a bit too proud.
Arrogant. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. I will translate the verse. Allah said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اذكروا النعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم وأني فضلتكم على العالمين. Oh, the Israelites, remember my favor upon you, which I have bestowed over you, that I favored you in your time over the rest of the nations. And Allah said, وَأُوفُوا بِعَهْدِي أُوفُوا بِعَهْدِكُمْ وَإِيَّا يَفَتَّقُونَ. And fulfill my promise, I'll fulfill yours. What is God's promise? We go to Isaiah 42. There is a prophet who will come from Kedah. Who's Kedah? When you go to Genesis 25:13, Kedah is the son of Ishmael. And he says, let the people of Kedah, the inhabitants of Kedah, rejoice. The people that of mountain of Sira. Who is the mountain of Sira? In Saudi. Historically speaking, from the Muslims and the non-Muslims, there is no prophet came from that place except Muhammad, son of Abdullah, son of Abdul Muttalib, son of Hashim. Then he goes back to who? The son of Qaydar, son of Ismail, son of Ibrahim. You see what I'm saying? That example of that. Prophet Muhammad prophesied 1400 years ago.
Yeah.
He said, there will come a time when you see the barefoot Arab man competing in building tall buildings. When the Prophet Muhammad mentioned that, back then the people were not known to build tall, the Arabs were not known to build tall buildings. You know what I mean? Those who were known, the Persians, the Romans, the Egyptians, the Greeks.
Yeah.
Now, maybe you know, maybe you do not know. Where is the tallest building in the world?
Dubai.
The next one is Saudi.
They compete with one another.
KSA, all
these. You know what I mean? The Arab Peninsula, which is Dubai, Qatar, Abu Dhabi, was 50 years ago, pure desert, let alone 1400 years ago. So Prophet Muhammad prophesizing about it is taking place right now. A person might say, they're doing it because they read it in the book. But God will never let false prophet prophecy come to pass like that in details. Because Prophet Muhammad, and likewise Prophet Muhammad, were not saying it as encouragement to do it. Rather, as Sheikh Fawzan said, he was what? Warning against it.
Warning
against it. Because why are you going to waste your money?
Yeah.
Building people dying out of anger. You know what I mean? Where are you going to reach? The cloud? You know what I mean? Another prophecy, Prophet Muhammad said, there will come a time when the Muslims, they will take over Constantinople. You know Constantinople? Turkey. Before it was called Islamabu. You know that? You must like a good city of Islam. Yes? The Muslims took over Constantinople 800 years, something after the migration of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I'm saying, when you bring all these proofs together, there's not any doubt Muhammad is a true prophet. I will give you something which I will ask you a question. Do you know any book on the earth that has been memorized, the size of the Quran, that has been memorized by millions of children, millions of young men, millions of young women, millions of old men, millions of old women? Bear in mind, they don't speak the language of the book. You know what Allah said? وَلَقَدْ يَسَّنَّ الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. We have made Quran easy to be memorized. When this verse was revealed, the Muslims, they were not even 2,000. Allah made that's a prophecy, and it's taking place right now. That is a miracle. Imagine you and I, we don't speak Chinese, but we memorize a book the size of the Quran in Chinese. It can happen, you know what I mean? That is a miracle.
Well, does the Prophet have children?
Prophet Muhammad son had children, yeah. He had four daughters. As some scholars mentioned, there were three boys or two boys.
And did they have children?
Fatima had children, yes, except Fatima.
So Fatima is the Prophet's bloodline now?
Yeah, my lineage goes back to Prophet Muhammad.
So you're the child of Prophet Muhammad?
Yeah, offspring. Yeah. Goes back to Prophet Muhammad.
So he's basically a great grandson. So what do you call someone like you?
Who are you, sir? Just of Ahl Bayt.
You're Ahl Bayt?
Yeah.
So the Quran, when it says talking about Ahl Bayt, it's talking about you.
No. In general, yes, maybe, but we're specific about the wives. And maybe, like you can see about us. But it was when the verse was revealed, we were talking about the wives. Then the hadith include Ali and Fatima and Hassan and Hussein. That Allah purified them. But
Ali is Fatima's husband, isn't it?
Yes, and the cousin of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
So Ali's children are the only children of Prophet Muhammad.
From his, from Fatima. Yeah. Okay. But before
so
I will
why
go.
Why did the Sunnis hate him so much?
Hate him? We don't hate him.
We don't hate
him. That's a lie. We love him, Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Are you Sunni?
Of course, I'm Sunni.
Okay.
Ali ibn Abi Talib, we love him.
Exactly.
He's one of the companions that anyone speaks so ill of him, he's a person of misguidance.
So what
about his children? His children does not. What you have to understand, Islam, that shows you the justice of Islam. Islam doesn't mean because you are a family of Prophet Muhammad, therefore you're there. No, you have to do good actions.
I've read about the grandchildren of the Prophet, and I mean, the Prophet himself prophesied stuff about them while he was still alive.
Yeah.
It must have been something significant.
Like one of them are told to prophecy. Prophet Muhammad said about, brothers, brothers, you love speaking same time. Prophet Muhammad said, Sayyidi Ibn Hada, Abu Hassan, Sayyid.
That's his son, yeah?
His son, Hassan. Grandson.
Grandson.
Yeah. He said he's a leader. And Allah, سَيَسْلُحُ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَيْنَ فِئَتَيْنِ عَظِيمَتَيْنِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah will rectify through him between two great group from the believers. And that took place 40 Hijri between Muawiyah's army and the army of Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Rectify Muawiyah, between the two. That same guy that made everyone curse Imam Ali on the pulpit.
No, that's not true. That's not true. Historically speaking, it's not true. That happened, they said, after Marwan ibn Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. But what I was going to tell you, before we go to these issues, what I said so far about the wisdom of the Creator, does it make sense to you?
I've always thought.
Like God sending the messengers, Prophet Muhammad, of course, makes sense.
Of
so what is stopping you to become Muslim?
I think my life's a lot wider than that.
Yeah, but are your life wider than worshipping your Creator, the one who created you, the one who provides for you?
This is the way I see it.
Yeah.
Whoever you believe created you, there's something in your head, isn't it?
Yeah, and something outside.
And you honestly believe that thing in your head is the truth?
No, not me personally, but
no. What's in your head? You believe it's the truth or a lie?
No, but not because it's in my head.
No.
Because I can prove it outside.
I'm not talking about anyone else. I'm talking about you.
Yeah, me, because I can prove it outside.
Yeah, but do you believe that what's in your head is true?
No, that's what I'm saying, because I can prove it outside. Now, as something comes to my head, that some bad things come to my head.
No matter why you believe
it's
true.
I don't believe it's true.
Why you believe it's true is a different issue. But the fact that you believe is true, what you believe, do you believe is true or false?
Which one are you talking about?
What you believe.
About the Islam is true.
Everything you believe in.
No, I believe some false things. I believe some is false. I believe some things is true.
But
Islam
would you
is
believe
true.
The false thing?
Yeah, I believe that are false.
If you found out science false?
I believe that are false.
But would you believe is true?
That's what I'm saying. It's not true. It's false.
You can't believe it's true.
Yeah.
No, false.
So at the end of the day, what you believe is true can only be affected from the outside sources unless you do something inside you, but you also need more stimulus and more information to get more pieces of the puzzle.
What do you mean, man?
What I mean is, what he thinks are lies and what you think are lies might be two completely different ideas. You have the basics of what Islam explains what it is, yeah? But he might see something, you might see something. You know what I mean?
But us, when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not about our thinking, because we know Allah told us.
I know what you mean, yeah, fam, but what I'm saying is when someone thinks God is a woman and someone thinks God is a man, basically, to them, that's the truth.
Yeah, but I forgot about what is in their head.
But to them, they can prove it to themselves. Same way, you can prove it to yourself.
I give an example.
Do you get what I'm saying?
No, I understand your point, but that is not... You know, Ibn Taymiyyah, one of the Muslim scholars, addressed this point.
Okay.
This point, let us be realistic. There are some things, yes, exist in your head, is true. But we're not talking what only exists in your head, we're talking in the real life.
Yeah, for example, what exists from your head comes from the real life.
Not all the time. For example of that, Christians, they believe Jesus is God. Is it God in the real life? It's not. Jesus, according to them, he was overpowered by Jews. But they say God's all powerful. If it's God all powerful, he cannot be overpowered by anyone else. So in the real life, Jesus cannot be God. Only exists in their head. Do you understand that?
In their life, that's all they call.
That's a different point. But my point...
But do you understand what I'm saying?
I understand that.
If all you're told is Jesus is God,
yeah,
and in your head you believe Jesus God is the truth...
But in the real life, what about in the real life? Because it's not about... What I'm saying, it's not about what only you think in your head. It's about the real life. Example. In my head, I believe a donkey, he has 20 legs.
Yeah.
There's a donkey after me 20 legs. In the real life.
You can...
No, in reality,
you could do that, but a born donkey, no, he doesn't stand in
that's,
need.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So these things only exist in people's head, they don't exist outside. For example,
but
knowledge.
You're talking about metaphysical things being proven by scientific methods?
No, I'm not talking about this.
Supernatural things being proven by...
No, I'm not talking about this. No, example of that. When you, what I'm saying, there is only things exist in your head. I agree with you. There's philosophers speak about this issue.
You're talking about creativity and imagination. We're talking about belief based on the knowledge you gain. So the Quran says that heaven has a tree, it has a river of honey, it has what this
paradise. Yes.
However, yes. God tells you in the same book that there's nothing in the heaven that is like anything you've seen, and you can never imagine it.
The names just similar.
So the way I see it is that if I see something there, you never saw it. I don't know what it's called. I've never been taught about it. I've never seen it. But I tell you, look, it looks like half a tree, half a horse. These are two things you've seen, but because you haven't seen that thing, you don't know. You can only imagine. You know what I'm trying to say? You don't know what I saw.
Of course, I don't know.
But I know you know what a tree is, and I know you know what a horse is. So it's the only thing I can... It's the only words that you understand that I can talk to you in. I can't talk to you in Chinese.
That's what I'm saying.
So what you believe in your head might be a different thing to what he believes in his head.
No. There's some issues. Maybe I agree in some things.
Do you get what I'm trying to say, though?
Yeah, I understand your point, but your point is not really...
Valid.
It's not valid.
Why?
You know why? Let me give you an example.
I've made my point.
You know, you keep talking about what you believe in your head only is true because it's in your head.
No. I'm saying to you, what you believe is true.
Yeah, not to him. Maybe what to him is not.
No, what he believes is true, he believes is true.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
What you believe is true, you believe is true.
It's subjective.
Yeah. So what I'm saying
that's
is,
what I'm saying,
this subjectivity.
Yeah, but that's applied to Islam. Because Islam is objective. Yeah. And we can prove
how
that.
How can God blame you or judge you or put you in hell for something that you believed in your heart to be 100% true?
Because No, no, God, that's a good point. That's what Allah said in the Quran. Allah will not do that. Allah will blame you if the truth comes to you and was clarified to you and you turn away from it. For example, imagine I became Muslim and I never knew that smoking drugs haram. I never knew that. So I never knew I'm smoking drugs. It's a sin. However, I will not be held accountable for it because I never knew. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But if someone came and explained to me, okay, then there's different thing. Likewise, doesn't mean because I don't know, therefore I should stay as ignorant. No, as a Muslim, Allah encouraged us to seek knowledge.
Islam is objective. You believe alcohol is haram, and as a Muslim, some other guy believes alcohol is halal.
Who does no Muslim believe that?
You say for example.
There's no forget for example. Let's talk
reality. Fine. Prove to me in Islam that alcohol is haram.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned clearly in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah mentioned the khamr.
What did he say exactly?
Let me quote the verse.
Do you not drink khamr?
No. Allah said worse than that. Allah said, "Fashtanibuh." You know, "Fashtanibuh" is worse than drinking. You know, "Fashtanibuh" this term. Are you in Arabic?
It means janab.
No, it means
siding away from.
Stay away from him. Like you know, look.
No.
I'll give you an example. Ibrahim said, "Shnubni wabaniya an na'bud al asnam." He's not saying to him, just say, move me away. No, mean that remove me far away from worshipping the idols. So, fashtanibu is severe terminology in a prohibition. Meaning that, that's
why... there are people who disagree, right?
No, there's not. There's no Muslim disagree.
I've heard Muslims who told me the same thing that you're telling me, but they said, like, put it to the side.
Okay,
a Muslim guy told me it means put it on the side of you.
So what Allah mentioned, okay, no, that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, yeah, but he was trying to tell me that Islam says you have to drink.
So now the best way.
Do you see the difference?
No.
You believe that? He believes that.
No. Listen, bro. Listen. What I'm saying, forget what he believes, what is outside the reality.
Bro, if he believes that, he drinks, is God going to punish him for drinking?
And he knows it's haram here.
He believes. That means keep hurting.
No, Allah punish him because he's not scholar of tafsir of the Quran.
He's not scholar, exactly.
Yes, what I'm saying.
How can he punish him for his ignorance?
Because why? What he's doing is committing the greatest sin for explaining the book of Allah with ignorance.
Yeah.
Because Allah said the worst of the sin to speak about Allah without knowledge. So for him to. Prophet Muhammad is the best person to explain the Quran to us. And he said there's 10 types of people who are cursed, the one who drink it, the one who carry it, the one who serve it. The one who sits around it. How on earth are these guys telling you, you put it next to you? We're personally cursed. So do you know what it means?
By the way,
it's severe, means you should stay far away from it.
This is in the Quran.
No, we don't follow the Quran. Allah said, in the Quran to us, for Prophet Muhammad as well.
So can I ask you another question about alcohol?
Why? But we divert.
I know. But this is the same point because it was very important.
Go on.
Because on the same thing, you said that's unclear. Yeah? God tells the people, do not go close to prayer.
While in a state of khamr.
Intoxicated,
yeah.
I know people who don't take intoxicants and they don't even pray.
It's haram.
And I know what you're saying. People who don't take intoxicants, but they don't even pray. Muslims, most Muslims that I know, don't pray.
Bad example for you, man.
I know Muslims that pray as well.
Alhamdulillah.
The brothers who take drugs are going to be more likely to not pray than the brothers who don't, all right?
Yeah.
So why is God talking to the people who are praying, don't go close to prayer while you're intoxicated?
Because you know what you said, Allah
explained. He's talking to a praying people.
No, just doesn't mean because you're going to pray, therefore you pray the way you like.
But why would God speak
to the
better part of the Muslims, the ones who pray?
No.
Yeah, and tell them, don't be juiced when you go pray.
No, see why you have misunderstanding. Allah, sir. Drunk because Allah explained, because you don't know what you're saying. Imagine I'm drunk, and instead of saying Alhamdulillah, I said, oh my Allah, praise idols.
Wait a minute.
So, likewise, when Allah told us to do a good deed, it's not because you do it enough, no. You have to do it correctly.
Yeah, but my point is, Allah easily said, لا تسكروا. لا تسكروا.
Allah said, no, because.
It's a lot simpler than لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى.
No, this one is much better than yours. You know why? Because this verse is one of the stages. The first stage, Allah mentioned in khamr, there is some benefit. However, the evil outweighs the benefit. Okay? That's the first stage. Because look to the wisdom of the Creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down a revelation to Prophet Muhammad to society. Khamri was their nature. Even the guy said, "Askini liyawma khamra wa ghada khamra." Give me khamra today and give me khamra tomorrow. And when I die, bury me next to the tree of graves in order for my veins to suck in the khamr from it. Just khamr, ashab khamr. So look at the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the verse showing that there is benefit in it. However, the evil outweighs.
Then there's something. Drinking a bit of alcohol is beneficial.
No, Prophet said no. So even the evil, the little one, no. But listen carefully. Yeah? Then the second stage,
using my
that they will allow you to drink, but before prayer, do not. So people start drinking with the prayer. Allah review the verse, do not pray while in the state of khamr.
And it's changed.
Then change after.
Why do we then still have this verse?
What, this verse what?
Why do we still have that verse?
Because there's a reminder.
It's irrelevant to us.
No, it's a reminder to show you. Because Allah has abrogation to Quran 3. One verse was abrogated. The ruling and the verse abrogated.
Sorry, what does abrogated
mean? I mean, abrogates mean that, for example, the verse about do not drink while on a state of intoxication is abrogated by the other verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said.
What does abrogated mean?
Mean the verse, like example of that.
It was omitted or something.
Removed the ruling.
Removed,
yeah, removed the ruling. Okay. For example, imagine you come to a doctor. Yeah. He will give you a medication for your body. Then you come after, he will give you another medication. People who think they are smart, he said, why didn't give me that medication in the first place? Yeah. He said, no, because your body wasn't ready for the second one.
Okay, yeah,
I give
you
the first one,
okay.
So the stages. Then the last one is shtenibu. But we have to think more about
it. We're already at that stage, you know what I'm saying? It's like this. Judaism, you as a Muslim, believe that Judaism is the same as Christianity, is the same as Islam, is the same as whatever Adam believed in.
No, Judaism, no.
Right.
You keep smacking this.
It's just you, bad positioning, but I'm left-handed, isn't it? But what I'm saying is,
question, I brought him three names.
Yeah. Oh, 1 minute. It's all right. No, it's okay.
No, go on. Yeah. Go on. I don't want to take your time. Yeah.
Brother, you look heavy.
Yeah, that's probably me. But first one is like, we talked about